What's up, gear mortals? Trey, Xavier here. Today I want to talk to you about putting together a pedal board for metal bass playing. So first of all, here is the sound of the bass just going straight into Pro Tools with nothing on it at all. It's okay, but you know, it's a good DI sound, but it's gonna need a lot of work before it's usable in a mix. So what we've got here is what I consider to be a pretty comprehensive metal bass pedal board. It's not real fancy in the sense that you can only get a couple sounds out of it, and it's basically set up to do like a clean tone, something pretty gritty and metal, and then something just really disgusting and super distorted with this fuzz pedal here. So I'm going to walk you through it and talk about why I set it up the way that I did to get the kind of sound that I like for heavy music. So the centerpiece of this board is a pedal that I was incredibly excited when I first heard about it. It's still pretty new. It's called Tyler the Frequency Splitter from a company called KMA Audio Machines. They make all kinds of awesome stuff. This, I think, is groundbreaking. It's something that's so simple that, of course, it needs to be made, and it's incredibly useful, but for some reason, I've never seen anything really like it in a pedal. So all it does is it takes your signal, and it splits it into two loops, one of them high-passed, and the other one low-passed. You can choose where exactly to high and low-pass in the frequency spectrum. You can blend it more towards one or the other side, and then you send it back out to your amp or front of house or whatever. And oh my god, like, the possibilities are endless. So of course, the first thing that I thought of was to do the old bass split and grit, which is what we're doing here, but you can do just all kinds of cool stuff with it on bass, guitar, synths, anything. Anytime you want to split the signal into the high sound and the low sound and process them separately, this is the way to do it in the analog realm. It's really easy to do digitally. If you're working in a DAW or something, it's easy to split the signal like that. That's no problem, but for a live purpose, having it on your pedal board, there it is. This is the jam right here. So that's kind of the centerpiece. Also on the board, we have the Dark Glass Alpha Omega Ultra, which has a bunch of stuff in it. I'm gonna talk about that in depth. We have this Arts in Bloodshed fuzz pedal, which is my favorite fuzz pedal ever. Real brutal, not for the faint of heart. You have to be kind of careful with it. It needs to be controlled. We've got the a tuner. This is just a Hotone tuner. It's actually terrible for bass. This is just to demonstrate that you need to have a tuner on your pedal board. I would not recommend this one for bass specifically, but it's small and it fit on there. So we've got the Moore Noise Killer gate. Once again, I mean, it's a fine gate. It's very simple. You might not need or care about having a gate. I like to have one just to cut out, you know, excess noise. I like to do a lot of fast stops and starts, so that helps with that. We got Tyler, and then we've got the Hyperluminal compressor from Dark Glass, which is a banger compressor. Basically, what you need to know is that any of these things, with the exception of Tyler, could be replaced with anything that does the same thing. You don't have to have these exact things or use my same settings or anything even close to it. The idea here is just the principle of having each of these things in a particular order. For me personally, I love having a super clean low end that's really compressed and then a really distorted clanky high end to kind of glue it to the guitars. And to me, that really fills out the mix. I think in a heavy music context, it's a formula that works basically 100% of the time. And being able to have a couple variations on that same idea just on one pedal board is really cool to me. And really, like, depending on the kind of music that you play, you might not need anything other than that. I know I don't. So let's talk about the signal path here. The bass is plugged into the tuner. That's very important that the tuner is the first thing in your signal chain, because not only is it going to tune your instrument, it also works as a mute. So when I'm tuning, nobody else needs to hear, okay? This is very important because it is super unprofessional to be tuning on stage while the crowd can hear you. I have seen this in action and it's pretty embarrassing. Actually, I saw a band tune by ear at full stage volume, everybody in the band at once, distortion on and everything, and Wow. You want to look like a noob, that's how you do it. So it goes from the tuner into the gate. If you're using a gate, that's a great place to put your gate, a great gate. You can also put it after whatever kind of distortion sound you're using, if your distortion pedal makes a lot of noise. Some people like to do both, more so for guitar than for bass, but it works in principle for either one. From there, we're going straight into the input of the Tyler. From there, we have the two different loops. Over here, we have the high pass loop. So this is where all our high sounds go. And then over here, the low pass, where all the low sounds go. And then here we have the high pass knob, and this sets where in the frequency spectrum you're high passing the signal. Then we have a mix, and the mix knob sets how much of the bass or treble side you're gonna hear. Then we have the level. This is the output level. Right now it is at unity, so it's not adding or taking away any output volume, it's just what's going in. Then we have the low pass, and that sets where you're low passing the signal. Of course, neither of these is marked for where exactly you're splitting the signal, but you know, you're gonna kinda do it by ear no matter what, so that's neither here nor there. This switch right here sets the polarity of the high end, and if you've got some kind of phase problems, you can use that to flip the phase, and that's pretty handy. In the high end loop, we're going from the output into the fuzz pedal first, from the fuzz pedal into the alpha omega, and from there back into the Tyler. And the reason for that is that I wanted to be able to use the cab sim on the alpha omega for the fuzz pedal if I wanted to. The reason that I picked the alpha omega specifically is because it covers the jobs of several pedals that I originally had in this design. It has a graphic EQ, it has distortion, a couple different distortion sounds, and it has a cab sim built in, so I literally took three pedals off of the board and put this on instead. Amazing. It sounds great. It sounds like a bunch of different stuff because it has this mod knob, so you can change the character of the distortion drastically. Being able to use it for the graphic EQ and the cab sim alone is already worth the price of admission, but the fact that it's also a preamp, a DI, a great sounding distortion that you can blend. It pretty much does it all. Pretty crazy that such a thing exists. I love Dark Glass. I love everything they put out. When it comes to metal bass, I think they are king. So that's the high end loop. Now the low end loop just has this hyperluminal compressor in it. So this is a really over the top compressor pedal, especially considering how small it is. It's a digitally controlled analog compressor that has three different types of compression in it. It does pretty much anything you want a compressor to do. In this case, we want basically like a liquid laser beam bar of low end. We want a nice, consistent, continuous low end that isn't gonna be all over the place. You wanna feel it all the time when you're hitting the bass. So I've got it set really hard just to be real compressed and very consistent with no dynamics. You can, of course, at any point, step on it and turn it off if you want to get a much more dynamic sound out of your bass. That's no problem. That's why it's a pedal board. That's why there's foot switches on it. I like to have it just hammering pretty much all the time, but with the option to clean it up a bit. So that's all that's in the low end loop. Honestly, I don't really think you need anything else to process the low end of your bass. I just want it to be really clean and really consistent, and this does that, so that's that. So it turns out I was actually one cable short when I was putting this together, and that would have been to take the DI output and put that back into the high end loop rather than going direct with the quarter inch. And the reason for that is that the cab sim on the Alpha Omega only applies to the DI out, to the XLR out. So right now what you're hearing, I've actually got the high end turned all the way down on the output of this, and you're actually hearing this part of it going into a separate track in Pro Tools. It's a little bit of a workaround. Depending on how complex of a setup you have for your live band, you might wind up running two different signals to front of house with something like this, and so this could be the way that you do that. If you wanna just go through all this with one output quarter inch into a separate DI, then I would have a quarter inch to XLR thing on here and go out here back into the loop. Right now we're kind of assuming that this pedal board is going direct to front of house and not into the front of the amp. If you're going to be going into the front of an amp, you're gonna wanna not use the cab sim on here. All right, so now let's turn everything on and see what kind of sounds we can get out of this rig. One of the cool things about the Tyler is that you can turn on the high and low loops separately, so you could hear just one or the other, which is really handy when you're dialing in a tone if you wanna just hear what the isolated high or low end sounds like. So check this out. This is the sound of just the high end. So the high pass is set reasonably high, but I also like to do it, like you can get it so tiny. You can get a whole huge range of different sounds out of even just setting the high pass to a different spot. Check this out. If you want it pretty clean, but with just a little bit of zing on the top, you can put it pretty much all the way up. Or if you want it a little bit more brash, turn it down a bit. Or if you want it a little bit almost disgusting, so even in just this one knob, we have a whole huge range of sounds. If we want it to sound even more disgusting, we can turn the high pass way down and distort more of the mid and low frequencies. And then of course, the further we turn this high pass knob to the right, the sludgier it gets. I find that to achieve more sludge, you just have more low-end distortion. It's less sludgy when you have a cleaner low-end and a distorted top-end. So actually, if you like it really sludgy, you probably don't want to use something like this at all. You want to just distort the entire sound of the bass. I find that when you do that, you lose a lot of low-end, so I don't really like it, but you know, it really depends on the style of music that you're playing. So now if we take it back to sort of a reasonable high-pass level, then we have a nice clean bottom end, clanky top end. It's sort of an inoffensive but banging metal tone. So let's try a slightly different sound on the Alpha Omega. I actually don't really love the bite switch. It is bitey, but you know, we'll go more towards the Omega end of the mod knob and hear what that sounds like. Here it is, all the way on the Alpha side. It's a lot less bright, actually. When you have it on the Alpha side, you almost don't need a cab sim. It's already very comparatively dark. Here it is with no cab sim at all. Versus using the Omega side is very brutal. Oof, almost like a fuzz pedal. So let's leave it in the middle for a bit. A lot of the choices that you're gonna make regarding all of this stuff is gonna have to do with what your bass sounds like in the mix with your band. What you don't wanna do is dial it in and lock it in, having only heard it soloed out. You wanna go and play a practice or a show and tweak it as you go so that you can get the effect that you're looking for. For me, I don't really want the bass to stick out that much, but it has to like sonically reinforce the sound that you're hearing. You want to be able to feel it, and you want to hear it a little bit. You want to hear just enough clank to really hold the guitars and the bass together. Once again, that depends very drastically on the kind of music that you're playing. The bass plays a crucial role in heavy music, and you have to get it right in order to really have a crushing sound, both live and in the studio. Sonically, your job isn't just to fill out the low end, but also to reinforce that middle and high end and to add to the overall gritty distortion of the sound. This might be especially true if there's only one guitar player in the band. When you're recording, you can double track the guitar and it'll sound really full. But when you're playing live, if it's just one guitar and the bass, you're probably gonna wind up using a lot more distortion than you would have otherwise. especially if your guitar player is going to play a solo, it's like having the rug pulled out from under you a little bit if the bass is too clean and then it's just lead guitar and bass. So if you need just more sonic destruction, I highly recommend using a fuzz pedal. So I'm going to bypass the distortion on the Alpha Omega, and I'm going to turn on this Arts and Bloodshed distortion pedal, and I'm going to turn the high pass down a little bit so that it sounds more distorted than it would have otherwise. So that's going to fill out the sound quite a bit more. When you're dialing something like this in, kind of what you're thinking about is how much of the guitar's space do you want to invade? Does it really need to be that abrasive and distorted? Do you need to back off a little bit and let the guitars do that? Or do the guitars sound a little weak and you gotta beef it up and really reinforce what they're doing? What you do with that is basically between you and the front of house mix engineer and the rest of the band. I can't really decide for you how much to do, but you can go super, super clean or really, really gritty and distorted. Maybe you play in a band like Lightning Bolt where it's just drums and bass, and you're basically the bass and the guitar. I can't make these decisions for you. I'm just giving you the options. So like I said before, in this case, the fuzz pedal is running into the Alpha Omega specifically for the sort of preamp and cab sim sounds. If I turn off the cab sim, ooh, we get just the gnarliest possible combination. That once again, not unusable, just real, real brutal. So by not bypassing the Alpha Omega, we're keeping it mellow enough to not really eviscerate people's ear holes. Then we've got the third option, or I guess the fourth option, of still having the processing of the Alpha Omega, just not the distortion on, so we get something that's very clean but still has a lot more character than just the DI. This is important because it's still full frequency. We still have the high end going through everything, and the EQ is on and all that, but it just doesn't have the drive or the distortion sound. And that's really nice to have if you've got a clean passage in the middle of all the brutality and something that would sound really awkward with a ton of distortion on it. Now you can still have a nice full frequency bass sound, but just a lot cleaner. And then you've got a really dynamic top end and a super compressed low end. And if you want it to be even more dynamic, you can just turn off the compressor for the low end. So long story short, you can get a ton of dynamics out of this one pedal board, lots of different kinds of sounds. So from basically straight up nothing at all, just the sound of the bass, to just the low end of the bass, or just the high end. Or the high and low end together, no compression still, to a very clean sound with compression on the low end, to a sound with the EQ and preamp in there on the high end, and a cab sim, of course, on the top end, to a pretty distorted sound, to something just outrageously crushing. So in my mind, for heavy music, this is an incredibly versatile pedal board. It doesn't do 100% of everything that you would need a bass pedal board to do for every style of music. There's no time-based effects at all. There isn't like an envelope filter or a wah pedal or any of the other crazy kinds of sounds that you could use. But for just a meat and potatoes, heavy bass tone, I think this covers as much ground as you could possibly need, and then a lot more. This kind of a setup will get you through just about any kind of heavy music gig you can imagine, if you know how to use it and how to set it up right. We have 4 or maybe even 5 different usable sounds, and with not a ton of pedals, it's not taking up a huge amount of space, it's reasonably compact and portable, it's not gonna set you back a ton of money. Everything on this board comes out to, I would say, around $1,500, including the power supply that I have underneath, which is a Dunlop ISO brick. And of course, you can expand it as much or as little as you want. You can put time-based effects in it. I would probably put those after everything that's here, so after the Tyler, before you go into the DI or into your amp. You could put anything that you want just here on the top end, maybe like a delay or a reverb where you don't want a lot of the washy low end coming through, but you want to hear the nice high end of that, of those repeats. You could put that in the loop for the high end. Or like an octave pedal, you could put in a couple different places within the signal chain to get a different kind of sound. This pedal board that we're using actually is built to expand. It's called the Extra Pedal Board from DC Pedal Board. And it actually, you can pull it out and make it longer, which I needed to do. As you can see, here's the seam. If you squish it, it's just this long. But I was halfway through putting this board together and I was like, oh my God, it needs to be longer. So you just grab it and pull it. Really cool. You know, you're gonna wanna plan out what you're doing before you actually buy a physical pedal board so that you can make sure that you have enough space for all the stuff that you're gonna do. And then of course, even those 4 or 5 sounds that I was telling you about can change drastically depending on the sort of choices that you make with your EQ, with how much distortion or drive you have up. You'll be able to get so much mileage out of a board like this with things that do these same jobs. Once again, like this doesn't have to be the fuzz pedal that you use. You don't have to use a fuzz pedal at all. You could use some kind of you could use a metal zone. You could put whatever you want in this slot or nothing. You could, this could be your wild card slot. It could be not a slot at all. You could take this off and just use this. Who knows? What the fuck do I know? Who do you think you are? The most important thing is that these principles apply across the board, both in the digital realm, the analog realm, and with whatever kinds of pedals you're actually using. A gate pedal is a gate pedal. They all do basically the same thing. Some of them better than others. Some of them have more parameters, whatever. Like this fuzz pedal has a 3-band EQ. A lot of fuzz pedals don't have a 3-band EQ. Some of them don't have an EQ at all. Like this Alpha Omega Ultra does an outrageous number of things, but you could have things that achieve all of those goals individually on here instead. For example, you could have an EQ on there that you prefer. You could have a different cab sim loader or no cab sim loader at all. You could have something like the 2 Notes Torpedo Cab M that's really small, that'll fit on your board and do the same thing. Use a different distortion pedal, whatever. Use more or less distortion. You could get a completely different sound that's tailored to your specific needs for your band or your songs or whatever. So I'm really interested to know what your guys' pedal board looks like. Does it resemble this in any way? Do you think I'm crazy? Do you think this is way too complicated and you just plug straight into an Ampeg 8x10 and call it a day? Whatever it is, let me know in the comments section below. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Thanks to Hosa Cables for sending us over the cables for this pedal board, especially these new flat patch cables. These are the shit. They are a godsend. They make putting together a pedal board way easier. As you can see here, they're just crammed into tiny little spaces. And yeah, really great. Super handy. If you're interested in joining our Patreon cult to get some behind the scenes, exclusive raw mix tracks, and get your name in the credits, just like these fine folks right here, you're gonna wanna head over to patreon.com/geargods. And I'll see you guys real soon.